comes from the Old Testament, the book of Micah, chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. With what should I approach the Lord and bow down before God on high? Should I come before him with entirely burned offerings, with year-old calves? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with many torrents of oil? Should I give my oldest child for my crimes, the fruit of my body for the sin of my spirit? He has told you, human one, what is good and what the Lord requires from you: to do justice, embrace faithful love, and walk humbly with your God. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, and for the word of God within us, we say,
thanks be to God.
Good morning. How are you? Doing good? How you feel? Are you relaxed? Oh, you got bug bites. Ouch. Well, today we're going to talk about feeling overwhelmed for the next 5 weeks. Have you ever felt overwhelmed? Not really. Wow, you must have a great life. That's awesome. How about you, Alice? Have you ever felt overwhelmed? Maybe. You guys? Yeah. The big kids start feeling overwhelmed sometimes. It's great when you're little, right? There's not a care in the world. What overwhelms you? When you have a million things to do. Yeah. And what does feeling overwhelmed feel like? What happens when you're overwhelmed?
You feel like you're going to have to do something.
You feel forced, yeah. What happens inside? What does it feel like?
Happiness, sadness, surprise.
Surpriseness, happiness, and sadness all mixed together. Yeah, that's a pretty good description. Does your head start spinning and your heart is pounding and you can't have one thought just by itself? That's how I feel. Well, I have a video for us to watch. Maybe you'll recognize something in it. Let's watch.
Ready, and then we'll get going.
No. Okay. Hey, what? You just lay out their clothes because it takes me 5 minutes.
Honey,
that's perfect.
Seriously.
Jack. Well, we're already late for church.
Hey, Brian.
Go get yourself dressed.
Did you pick up my stuff from the dry cleaners?
Make it.
Okay, Jack, I'm gonna make you waffles.
Can I have a sandwich?
Yes, but you gotta make it by yourself. Jack! Okay.
This is all I could find, and the zipper's broken.
All right, I'll go grab a safety pin.
I got the high score!
Hannah, what are you doing?
Daddy, I'm painting your fingernails.
Well, that's great, sweetie, but go get dressed.
still. Okay. Honey.
Come on, let's go.
Okay, everybody needs to eat. Here you go.
I need one.
Here you go. Okay, here you go.
I forgot my shoes.
Honey, we gotta go back.
Nobody's taking off their shoes. And I want everybody to understand that we're what?
We made it.
Yep.
From you that this goes over well and that everybody receives these great gifts and receives us in God's name. We need some desserts, so you can sign up to bring cookies or brownies for that day. We could use a couple extra pop-up tents to have on hand and some volunteers to be here to help in the kitchen, to welcome the children, to move them from haircuts to pictures. So there are places to sign up for all of those things to help, and our donation jar. They are, Friendship Tree tells me that they're expecting to give away 200 backpacks this year, and they run about $40 each. So with all the supplies in them, which really isn't bad when you think about it, a whole backpack and the supplies you need for the year. But that's a lot of money. And the last I spoke to Eloise Westcott, who organizes this, she said they were about halfway to what they needed. So there are lots of ways to help and support. If you can't be here on that day, you can donate and you can pray for donations to come in and for the children to receive all that they need to start the school year off right. So I ask you to keep that in your prayers this week and in the weeks ahead. The giveaway will be August 26th, so coming up just a couple weeks on a Saturday. And now I would ask you to please pray for me as I pray for you. So let us pray. Most gracious God, make your truth known to us this day and forever. You are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. About a month and a half ago, our son Wade turned one. I want to tell you about what happened in the months leading up to his first birthday. When he was about 6 months old, I had a fleeting thought about, oh, his birthday will be in the summer, we could have a little cookout with the grandparents. Then around 9 months, the grandparents started asking, what are the plans? What's his birthday gonna be? And I decided, well, I'd really like to bake a nice cake, a special cake, my first child's first birthday. That sounds like something that would be nice. Then a month after that, we finally set the date and told the grandparents and our siblings. Ben's sister was going to come from Florida. And then 2 weeks before, we thought, well, it might be fun to invite some other friends with young kids just to make it, you know, a party. So we let them know. And then the week before, my best friend told me she was going to fly in from Seattle to surprise us and celebrate with us and stay with us, of course. Great. And that night that I had that conversation, I started to order some decorations online and count up the guests to see how much food we would need to order, because with that many people, we wouldn't want to be over the grill all day. We might as well just order the food. And then the day before the party, Ben scrubbed down the porch and I baked my big fancy cake. And that afternoon of the party, I was running around feverishly preparing for 20 plus people to descend on our home, trying to get everything just right, or at least passable. And I found myself hanging up a backdrop behind Wade's high chair because the porch wall was just dirty looking and it would not look good in pictures. So as my mother-in-law was helping me decide what height to hang it at, I stopped and said, remember how this was supposed to be a small little get-together? And we laughed and everybody came and we ate and it was a great time. And it took me about 4 days to recover and about 2 weeks till everything was back in its place after moving all of our junk into clothes. closed-doored rooms. As a fellow pastor mom recently posted in our Facebook support group, she said the pressure to have a Pinterest-perfect first birthday party is real. Why do I do this to myself? And I immediately responded to her commiserating, saying that I was all on track to resist that pressure, but somehow, once again, I found myself sucked into the overwhelming pressure of self-imposed, unrealistic expectations. And her question still rings in my ears, why do I do this to myself? Today, we begin our series on feeling overwhelmed. Hearing God's response to all the ways in which we get overwhelmed in life. And it seemed to me that being overwhelmed by expectations was a good place to start, because I think most often the high expectations that tend to overwhelm us get set by ourselves. Feeling overwhelmed seems to have become a symptom of modern life. I would guess, honestly, most people, especially those of us responsible for caring for somebody or other people, we have at least one moment of feeling overwhelmed every day. If, at the bare minimum, every week. And as we all know, that's not a pleasant feeling. It's hard to be present to God's guiding spirit when your thoughts are racing. For most of us, these moments pass with a deep breath and some quiet time to think for a second. But for some, this constant overwhelmedness develops into anxiety disorders or depression or addiction or health issues. So why do we so often put ourselves in a place of feeling overwhelmed? I don't really feel like I have a great answer to that question. I'm sure some of it has to do with constantly seeing and hearing about people or celebrities that just go way over the top. And so they've set the bar so high that, you know, our little raised expectations seem like nothing compared to that. Or perhaps it's related to all the sharing of our lives that we do these days on social media, wanting to capture that picture-perfect moment for all of our distant friends and family to like. Now, I think it's important that you hear me say, there is no sin in planning a party for your kids. It's not wrong to want to go over the top sometimes and make a celebration extra special. There's no harm in it. If you find joy in doing that, if you want to make something special so that all the people celebrating can really recognize the great gifts God has given us and give thanks for our family and time together, go for it. But if, like me, you feel your blood pressure start rising, get anxious and stressed, or you start to feel depressed and you don't want to do anything at all, you feel like you're failing all the time because you're not perfect, then I've got to suggest we find a different way to be. All of us laughed at that video of the perfect family because we can all relate. Which means if someday you show up here to church with a chunk of your hair missing and a poppy on your shirt, we'll all understand. We've all been there. We'll probably say, rough morning, you're in the right place. Come on in. Most of the time, we are our own harshest critics, which simply prevents us from really our boss or a teacher, our parents or in-laws or a spouse. Sometimes the expectations are externally set too high. And we're basically set up to fail over and over again. And that seriously bites. It is certainly not something anyone who loves you ought to. And perhaps they don't realize they're doing it, but if it's a constant part of your relationship with someone that you're never good enough, then I want to encourage you to address that. And I'm happy to help you figure out a way to do that. Not that we shouldn't expect anything of people we love, but in loving relationships, there's got to be a certain amount of grace and understanding. Now from God, who shows us perfect love, we hear the expectations are simple, basic, though not always easy. The Message translation says this for Micah 6:8. God expects us to do what is fair and just to our neighbors, be compassionate and loyal in our love, and to not take ourselves too seriously, but take God seriously. What a great way to interpret walking humbly with your God. Don't take yourself too seriously. Take God seriously. I love that. And if we do it, if we really take God seriously, then we'll be taking God's expectations seriously. And I've found when I start taking God's expectations more seriously, it helps me release all the other expectations that I might create or that the world might try to put on me. When I can make a little space for God at the beginning of each day, I'm better able to focus on making my actions just and kind. When I come together each week with others trying to walk the same path, I find the encouragement and the support I need to keep walking humbly with God. When I take God seriously, I'm able to take myself less seriously. I'm able to be more realistic and forgiving with myself. I found this prayer recently, and I thought it was especially helpful. The other serenity prayer. Grant me the serenity to stop beating myself up for not doing things perfectly. The courage to forgive myself because I'm working on doing better. And the wisdom to know that you already love me just the way I am. It's so easy for our expectations to snowball and get carried away by the trivial things of this world, only to find ourselves totally overwhelmed and stressed out and not enjoying any of it. Even when we try to keep things simple, these expectations seem to sneak in and the pressure rises. But the prophet Micah reminds us, we don't need to try to impress God with thousands of burnt offerings or perfectly folded fitted sheets. God doesn't care about barrels full of oil or if we ever show up anywhere on time. God doesn't want us to sacrifice our children or time with our children as we worry about trying to live up to standards that don't really matter. What God wants, all God expects, is that we show justice, share kindness, and continue to walk humbly with our Creator. And in Jesus, in following Christ, we see how that's truly done at its best. So may we allow God's expectations to outshine any others that we might create for ourselves. May we take God seriously and not take ourselves too seriously. And when we're feeling overwhelmed by expectations, may we pause and breathe in God's loving spirit that reminds us we are loved and that there is grace freely available to us at every moment.
You call me out upon the waters, the great unknown, with feet naked. And there I find you in the mystery, in the ocean's deep, my faith will stand. You are mine, oh.
basic instructions given to us. Do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with God. And so if I'm going to practice what I preach and truly honor this calling to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, I cannot be silent today on the topic of racism and hatred. The events that occurred in Charlottesville, Virginia this weekend are appalling. And I would not be doing my job if I didn't clearly condemn them from the pulpit. Bishop Easterling of the Baltimore-Washington Conference released a statement last night, and I wanted to share part of her words with you today. Bishop Easterling writes, "As United Methodists, we have taken vows and entered into a covenant that compels us to act in the face of evil. In our baptismal vows, we affirm, when asked, 'Do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? And do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves?' These questions do not presume that we will simply reject evil, injustice, and oppression quietly in the confines of our homes and hearts. Rather, these questions imply, in true Wesleyan fashion, that we will actively resist this wickedness. We are called to action through prayer, standing in solidarity with those being persecuted, preaching and teaching love and inclusion, and denouncing acts born out of hatred." She shared recently, "I heard about the actions of one person leading to a collective movement to silence messages of hate. New Yorkers boarded a subway car to find swastikas and other symbols of fear and intimidation drawn all over the windows and walls. As the passengers looked in quiet disbelief, someone said, 'Well, hand sanitizer gets Sharpie out.' And soon everyone was passing around this liquid on napkins and tissues and wiping away these symbols of hate. The actions of one person led to a moment of constructive community activism and engagement. One person can spark a movement of love and healing." And so my prayer request for today is that we as Christians will follow the way of Christ by naming injustice and evil and doing the things we can to heal it, whether big or small. I pray we will use whatever platforms we have to condemn racism and white supremacy and actively work to put an end to it. We, of course, pray for those who were injured and the three people that lost their lives in the counter-protest. And we pray for all those who gathered to unite in hatred. I pray that God will have mercy on them and that their hearts might be changed. We've also been asked to join in praying today with the Global Council of Churches for peace on the Korean Peninsula, for peace in the hearts of our leaders, and for peace among all peoples. So with much to pray for today, let us join our hearts together as we lift our joys and concerns.